in just 2 years' time. And on the basis of that, no, I will become the general secretary of the Workers' Party, which became the Socialist Party of the Philippines, and then I would become also the general secretary of the Movement for the Advancement of Nationalism, which was a broad national united front. Also, Kabataan Magkabayan was important in the forthcoming organization of the Communist Party, not only because of its broad sweep, its involvement of workers, peasants, and middle class people, but also because, well, you have the kinds of strength and talents that would be developed under Kabataan Magkabayan. In 1967, I'm now moving very fast, no, towards the forming of the Communist Party. In 1967, there would be a dispute within the old Communist Party. And there was a dispute over the history of the party. And that was the main dispute. It's about the need to rectify the errors and weaknesses that had led to nearly the destruction of the old merger party. And the clash easily went from ideological and political to the organizational, because my confreres in the executive committee, which would become the core of the future central committee of that old merger party, was dominated by science, children of that family, which dominated the old merger party. The family is Lava family, and it's a family with brilliant members. So Lava was general secretary from 1942 onwards. Dr. Vicente Lava, a chemist, who was educated in Cornell University. No? Then the next one would be a lawyer, one of the top students of the College of Law. The next general secretary. And then the third one would be a doctor of medicine. No? So, so from one Lava brother to another, the leadership was passed over a period of more than a decade. And in the executive committee where I was, there were two nephews of the Lavas and two were friends. The only ones independent of that family would be the leader of the trade union movement and myself, no? Leading the youth movement, no? So, anyway, the dispute was about history and responsibility, and then the other issue would be, you know, the debate in the international communist movement between Marxism-Leninism and modern revisionism, represented by Khrushchev, no? The forefather of Gorbachev, no? Who wanted to restore capitalism, no? So, the split will become internationally known, with the side of the proletarian revolutionaries issuing their statement through Beijing Review, no? And the other side would be issuing its own statement in the information bulletin in Prague. Huh? So, I hope you would. Anyway, the Communist Party, the new one, would be reestablished in 1968. So, after the separation from the old merger party. And the proletarian revolutionaries were more in number. And also, you know, when there was a competition of having more of the original, those who were cadres in the 30s. We have the oldest of the originals. No? The other side had only 1935 no? Cadres. We have 1933 cadres. No? One was also 1930. You could not get more because many of them were dead. No? Now the Communist Party would give birth to the new People's Army. The founding, the reestablishment of the Communist Party of the Philippines was December 26, 1968. A few months afterwards, the new People's Army would be founded on March 29, 1969. So to develop the revolutionary movement, cadres from the city consisting of workers and educated youth would go to the countryside and work among the peasants, and they joined up with cadres of the old movement, cadres of the party, of the old party, who took outside, and as well as the better part of the old people's army. There were remnants of the old people's army, and the overall leadership was rotten. It was called the leadership, the Taru Sumulong Gangster Clique, which was making a lot of money, protection money from gambling, from gambling and prostitution and so on in cities of Angeles and Olongapo, close to the U.S. military bases. And also this group, even by pretending to be for the peasants, were concentrated more on making money also from the garbage, garbage of the military bases in Clark and Subic. That's a lot of money, and the garbage, because you know the metals from the ammunition and so many other things. So the New People's Army had to repudiate that kind of leadership and got the better part, those who were really doing good work for the peasants. So the old merger party became rotten. Even while we were there, they could not get rid of old ideas which would prevent the development of the revolutionary movement. And when we did the organizational work to develop the revolutionary movement, we built the branches of the Communist Party in the Philippines. We built units of the People's Army. We built mass organizations underground, aside from the vulnerable above ground organizations. I would say vulnerable because Marcos would wipe out. No? By declaring martial law, he would wipe out. No? He started wiping out the mass organizations in 1971 with the suspension of the writ of habeas corpus, and when he declared martial law, it was a total wipeout, no? At the legal level. So, but then there was a big game for the underground. No? Those who could no longer move underground joined the underground and the People's Army. So, thanks to Marcos. He did and unwittingly he did a fan service to the revolutionary movement. He thought he was going to destroy it, but instead he sent plenty of activists to the revolutionary movement. We also formed the organs of political power, that means to say people's committees of people's self-government. In every village where the revolutionary movement spread, And alliances were created, no? I will explain to you quickly what this alliance will mean. You know, at the highest level, you have an alliance of the working class and peasantry. That's the most important. That's called the basic alliance. Then you have additional forces. The urban petty bourgeois will be part of the alliance of progressive forces. Further on, include national bourgeois or middle bourgeoisie with ambitions of industrializing the Philippines. So that means that's the alliance of patriotic or progressive forces. And then the alliance also may involve temporary and unstable, unreliable allies, no? Sections of the reactionaries who are better or look better simply because they're not the ones in control, no? So they oppose as enemy the reactionaries in power. You get the point. There's a split among the reactionaries. You can have arm's length alliance with that. In the countryside, you have an alliance of the poor peasants and farm workers under the leadership of the working class, of course, no? And that basic alliance is further extended to the alliance with the middle peasants. And then further on, you have an alliance with the rich peasants who do not have much interest in land reform, but who have quite patriotic spirit. And then there is also a contradiction among the landlords. The small landlords who are not in power and who naturally distinguish themselves from the big ones with large private armies and with access to the regular military and police, no? So, anyway, I would say that I was involved in the foundation of the revolutionary movement, especially in its form of People's War, from 1968 to 1977. 1977 was the year of my capture, and that was the beginning of my detention by the military up to the fall of Marcos in 1986. Your professor has already referred to the torture I underwent. I was in solitary confinement for 5 years. That murder was the most difficult part of my incarceration, but I underwent also physical torture. So I underwent punching and then what is now called nowadays waterboarding. By the way, that's an American invention. Against the Indians, against the Mexicans during the mid 19th century, and during the American aggression against the Filipinos, the Cubans, and the Puerto Ricans. The water cure takes many forms, no? The best known is nowadays is the waterboarding. You are made to have sensation of drowning. You are deep in water. The one applied on me was to shut my mouth, pour water through my nostrils. That was for several hours. But you know, I consider all those physicals nothing in comparison to the psychological torture of solitary confinement. You know, you are in a small cell with my 1 foot shackled to the cot, no? COT, and one hand attached, and you don't see anyone except an officer that would be looking through a bay window. So I underwent. So that you will have the chance to ask the questions, I would end my presentation here, and at least I covered 20 years very quickly from 1938, the beginning of my activism, to the fight captured by the fascists in 1977.
I was thinking maybe before we open it up for questions, shall we take a short break? Let's come back at 5 minutes past the hour. So that gives you about 7 minutes.
How exactly I was not quite
clear. No, we are 2 minutes to 12, so that was...
Ah, yeah.
Okay, 2 minutes.